Hi, I'm Micah Halpern. Thank you for joining me today as I do some thinking out loud. Our first segment is called Background Briefing. The first thing I've been thinking about is elections and politics in Israel. I've been thinking a lot about them. After all, they just had the fourth election in 2 years. It's over and the doomsayers are out. Of course, the analysts and commentators and columnists have bemoaned the results just like they did in previous elections, all three elections. Not me, of course, but they do. Never bemoan an election. Never, ever, ever, ever bemoan democracy. The ability to vote and through that process to have a voice heard is a privilege not granted to all, and you got to take it seriously. Having your voice heard by selecting political leadership is a great responsibility. These freedoms should not be bemoaned. They should not be downplayed and never degraded or taken for granted. So yes, Israelis went to the polls for the fourth time in 2 years. And for many, this need to repeat the process so many times over is interpreted to be indicative of the fractured nature of Israeli politics, the fractured nature of Israel's voters. It is seen as a negative, and that's in great part because this election, like previous three, failed to bring about the emergence of an easy coalition of 60 plus seats in the Israeli Knesset. The critique is overwhelming, and it goes like this. The election was the same as the past. Israel has not changed. Israel is divided. Just as overwhelming are the calls for unity and for dramatic change in Israel in order to bring people closer together. The critique is incorrect. Incorrect. Change would be a massive mistake. Unity, my friends, is overrated. Unity is a myth, especially when applying it to the notion of a nation. And unity, most importantly, is not a useful political tool. The reason should be clear. The last four decades serve only to once again hammer home that point. Israel cannot unite because there are very little that Israelis agree upon. The differences are not new and should not be surprising. For the past 77 decades, the same issues have plagued Israeli society. Religious versus secular, rich versus poor, immigrants versus old-timers, European versus Middle Eastern cultures. Differences within the country are good for the country. Differences make up a country and create a national fabric that is alive and always changing, never stagnant, never complacent. In this way, Israel is blessed with many times over. Those blessings should be counted, not criticized. Israel is a country of immigrants. It always has been a nation composed of people from all over the world, people with various backgrounds and languages and cultures, dress, food, education, traditions. They come from Europe and from the Middle East, from the United States, from Asia, from Africa, even from India. They come from around the world. And it is their differences that make Israel a more interesting and better nation. And it is their differences in politics and voting choices that make Israel a living and breathing democracy. Opposite sides of the spectrum will never agree upon certain issues. Ardent secularists can continue to push and cajole and even threaten religious parties, and they will not agree with the religious parties to change the status quo and the religious nature of the state. Supporters of the settler movement will never agree with detractors that their actions are a deterrent to peace. National service, whether army or volunteer, will always be a point of contention in certain communities. But despite the many divisions among Israelis, several of which are highlighted by political issues and the political process, those issues are dwarfed by the bonds that do unite them. And those bonds have nothing to do with politics. Almost every man, woman, and child in Israel is united on issues concerning defense and security, regardless of political party. Theodore Herzl, whose vision turned into the realization that Israel is the Jewish state, or the state of Jews, as he called it, exists today. He said that over 100 years ago, the Jewish people is a nation, our enemies have made us one. That's his quote. For many, anti-Semitism is the fulcrum that unites the Jewish people. When there are threats against Israel, politics dissolve. When there are threats against Israel, it makes no difference which party is in power. The country comes together. But that is a false sense of unity. Obviously, when there were crises and attacks from the outside, the people inside band together to fight for survival. That happens in every culture and in most countries. But still, insiders do not agree with one another. Being united is overrated, and it is always unattainable. There is an alternative. Advance the idea that despite disagreements, civilized discussion and discourse about differences and those differences of opinions should be conducted. Rather than aspiring for unity, a better objective might be to strive for mutual respect. Coming up next, points of view. I want to discuss two columns today. The first is from the Jerusalem Post. It's an editorial by Emily Schrader. She's a regular. And it was published on July 29th, 2021. And it's entitled, Biden Recognizing Armenian Genocide is Righting a Historic Wrong Opinion. And it's subtitled, Only in 2019 did the United States pass a resolution recognizing the massacre. Yet, as of now, a U.S. president has yet to do so. Are the tides finally turning? This issue that Schrader presents in this opinion piece is important for us to consider. She clearly argues the ethical, moral position to recognize the Armenian genocide of World War I. World War I, even after all these years. Here is how Schrader begins. The Biden administration reportedly will recognize the Armenian genocide in a historic and long overdue decision by the United States. In a morally inexcusable shortcoming, Israel and many other nations have failed or even refused to recognize the Armenian genocide committed by the Ottoman Turks in 1915 against the Armenian Christians. Only in 2019 did the United States pass a resolution recognizing the massacre. Yet, as of now, a U.S. president has yet to do so. Are the tides finally turning? The genocide is seen by many historians as the precursor to the Holocaust. And its lack of recognition has often been cited as evidence for why remembering the Holocaust is crucial to prevent genocides in the future. Despite overwhelming evidence and eyewitness testimonies, there has been controversy over recognition due to Turkey's adamant refusal to accept responsibility for the massacre. In the case of Israel, the government has refused to recognize the Armenian genocide due to the volatile yet strategic political relationship with Turkey. For decades, Turkey has blackmailed and threatened nations if they even considered recognizing the Armenian genocide. Schrader now explains that historically, Israel had very few friends, and Turkey was one, and Israel simply could not afford to alienate Turkey. But today, Turkey is hardly a friend of Israel, she writes. Initially, this wasn't something Israel could politically afford. Israel relied heavily on Turkey as one of the only Muslim states with which it had cooperation and diplomatic relations. Yet through the decades, Turkey has become increasingly hostile to Israel, with the dictatorial and Islamist President Recep Tayyip Erdogan. Not only that, Turkey is increasingly aligned geopolitically with Iran. Today, Israel is less dependent than ever on Turkey, especially with emerging relations with Arab states. Yet, instead of recognizing the Armenian genocide and unequivocally standing on the right side of history, the Israeli government has sold out the Armenian people even today by selling weapons to Azerbaijan while it bombs Armenian cities. Schrader now moves the discussion to the United States, and Schrader writes, In the case of the United States, Armenian genocide recognition has come up numerous times over the decades. Yet there was only formal recognition in 2019. 40 years ago, U.S. President Ronald Reagan used the word genocide to refer to the event in a major step forward toward recognition. Yet after a Turkish uproar, the U.S. Congress failed repeatedly to recognize it due to the political issues. Similarly, U.S. presidents from left and right have avoided using the term genocide so as not to antagonize Turkey. Schrader's conclusion is very straightforward. Western powers should recognize the Armenian genocide. It's very simple. She writes in her words, If even a few of the world's superpowers had recognized the Armenian genocide from day one, we would be living in a different reality today, where smaller nations wouldn't be afraid to acknowledge the obvious historical fact to the detriment of a people that was almost eliminated. The Biden administration, recognizing the Armenian genocide, would not only send a morally necessary message to the people of Armenia on behalf of the United States, it also would send a message to the world. The time for recognition is now. Well said, Emily Schrader. Well said. Next up is a column by Rabbi Hanoch Teller. It's from the Jewish press. The Jewish press's motto, by the way, which is very interesting, is first and always politically incorrect. First and always politically incorrect. Teller is a producer of three films, award-winning films, noted, a popular teacher in Jerusalem, in yeshivot and seminaries, the author of 28 books. He's a masterful storyteller, one of the greatest Jewish storytellers in the world. Hanoch Teller and Penina Shriam, another great, have transformed modern storytelling, certainly Jewish storytelling. Teller's latest book is entitled Heroic Children, and in the book, he chronicles the lives of 9 child survivors of the Holocaust. Rabbi Teller is a senior docent at Yad Vashem and is frequently invited to lecture in different communities throughout the world. I taught with Hanoch for many years and even brought him to Eastern Europe on his first of many trips. This piece offers an explanation of Zionism as seen by religious establishment, the establishment before the state, Zionism before the state. Teller starts out by setting the stage, a great storyteller, of course, and writer. This is how Teller begins. When Herzl launched political Zionism, it was widely embraced by Jewry, who viewed it, like its founder, as a solution to an unviable existence. The popularity of Zionism among world Jewry is evidenced by the strategic planning of the British government leading up to the issuance of the Balfour Declaration. I have never uncovered an historian who believed that His Majesty's government issued the Balfour Declaration because of its pity over the suffering of the Jews and their legitimate rights to their ancient homeland. On the contrary, Britain had an agenda, and there were numerous factors that made it politically expedient for Britain to issue the declaration. One was its interest in currying the favor of world Jewry in 1917. Britain, as well as France, desperately wanted to keep Russia in World War I for as long as possible and keep Germany occupied on the Russian front. Because of February Revolution, Russia, involved in the civil war at home, was hardly interested in engaging in a world war simultaneously. Admittedly, I am simplifying. Britain also wanted to get America committed to the war as fast as possible. Teller explains that Jews around the world were positively inclined towards Zionism, and he is absolutely correct. He writes, thus, the real motivator for the British was to win over the Jews, and Zionism seemed like the promising card to play. World Jewry was by and large, Zionistically inclined, and in America, Zionism's strength was only rising. Staunchly religious Jews, however, viewed matters otherwise. Fundamentally, they felt it was not their place to come to Israel prior to God leading them there. But there were other factors in their rejection as well. Teller gives 3 reasons why religious Jews rejected Zionism. The first is that it replaced the Torah. He writes, Zionism redefined Jewish people. It was no longer a people based upon Sinai and revolution, upon Torah and tradition. It was rather to be a people with a shared culture. This said, culture not being non-Jewish in the original origin and outlook and dedicated to the goal of nationhood for the sake of nationhood itself. Rav Sadia Gaon's ancient statement that our people is a nation by virtue of its acceptance of the Torah has been the foundation of Jewish life for millennia. Zionism denied this premise. Rather, they believed our people is a nation because of culture, geography, nationalism, and persecution, a new slogan of Zionism. It was an idea that religious Jewry could not accept. Even the religious Zionist movement never agreed with this philosophy of Zionism, but rather attempted to adopt a pragmatic program of cooperation with the Zionist movement to bring about Jewish statehood and physical security. Many religious Jews shied away from even such a program, seeing only the new philosophy of Zionism, which they regarded as being wrong, dangerous, and ultimately self-destructive. The second reason Teller gives is that the new state's leaders were not religious, and they adopted enlightened ideas like the revival of Hebrew. And he concludes by explaining that it was the messianism that religious Jews also rejected. He writes, the third factor that caused religious Jewry to reject political Zionism was its unclaimed, unspoken, yet nevertheless inherent messianic quality and message. Many looked at the Zionistic movement as a vehicle that would restore the Jewish people to their ancient greatness and fulfill the lofty promises of the prophets. Theodor Herzl was a dynamic revolutionary and an innovative leader, but he was not, contrary to the view of many downtrodden Jews in the late 1800s, the Messiah. Hanuch Teller is correct, but other religious Jews did embrace Messianism, believing it to be the beginning of the dawn of the Messiah. Teller tries to explain why there is a community of religious Jews who then and still now reject Israel and Zionism. That's what his real purpose is. Where he stops short is evaluating that the value that they created and their actions were wrong. They were wrong. They were very wrong. They were wrong now and they were wrong then. Zionism transformed the Jewish people. It changed the paradigm. And even the rejectionists of Israel and Zionism need to realize that. In no uncertain terms, the world is a different place because Israel exists. The world is a better place because Israel exists. The world, not just the Jewish people. Coming up, commentary through cartoons where pictures tell the story. I'm going to show you seven cartoons and memes today. Headlines also. Let's begin with some headlines. This one reads, Illinois senator who sponsored no cash bail law was upset that a man threatened him with a gun was released on $1,500 affordable bail. It's absolutely ridiculous. We have to realize the $1,500 bail was so little. But politicians are oftentimes hypocrites, and many of them often embrace the do as I say, not as I do philosophy of life. They preach one idea, but they live a very different one. Next up is funny, and it pokes at both the total ignorance that we have in our world today, as well as COVID, the new COVID reality. One of the things that so upsets me is when people embrace their ignorance with such gusto and pride. And this is an example of it. It happens all around us. The headline reads, U.S. woman orders a dozen masks, then complains only 12 arrived. Now, a growing idea that actually suggests that the new COVID reality may be with us forever. The headline reads, Oregon health officials propose making mask mandates permanent. Permanent is a very long time. That was a joke, by the way. Permanent is a very long time. Here is a real description of a situation. The largest ship in the world, the Evergreen, ran aground in the Suez Canal. It blocked the movement of goods from Asia to Europe. More than 13% of the world's goods pass through the Suez Canal every day. The headline reads, Suez Canal ship crisis may unleash worldwide toilet paper shortage. That's funny. This next meme is a funny play on the ammo shortage in the United States. So many people have bought weapons and ammo. There is just a shortage around. There's not enough for everyone, not enough to fill the demand. Remember, it's all about your perspective. So a reporter asks a deer, how do you feel about 2021? The deer responds, I'm pretty excited about the ammo shortage. That's funny. Here we have an old, dilapidated cassette tape. It was found. Remember those? It's actually the best of Leonard Skinner. The caption reads, a kid found this in the creek and asked if it was from the Civil War. To most kids, old is just old. This next meme is for those people who are starting to travel again. When you re-enter the airplane, you will need to readjust to the plane's new normal. This meme demonstrates how the airlines view their passengers. We have an image of a person, actually two people, it's the same person repeated twice. He's sitting in airline seats, one seat in front of the other. The person has unusually short legs. The caption reads, what airlines think humans look like. And this last meme is a young boy shoveling snow. The caption reads, this was GoFundMe when I was growing up. That makes sense. In a moment, more of my own perspective and a few predictions. In Argentina, fans shout that Chacha is coming along the road, killing Jews to make soap. This is a direct anti-Semitic slur directed against Jews. Chacha is short for the team Chacha Kirita, the team which was preparing for a game against their longtime rival Atlanta. Atlanta, like Chacha, comes from the Crespo neighborhood in Buenos Aires. Many Jews live in the neighborhood, but Atlanta has a long history of positive relations and open relations with their Jewish fans and their Jewish administrators and even some Jewish players over the years. Jewish fans have supported Atlanta for years, ever since its founding in 1904. This is not the first time a reference to soap has been made. In 2000, Chacha also did the same thing. The fans shouted about soap and Nazi flags and Atlanta fans. And then they chanted, "Jews were made of soap." In 1988, Argentina actually passed laws forbidding this kind of hate speech, making it illegal and punishable by imprisonment. Yet in certain circles, it persists. Iran shot another missile at an Israeli tanker. It happened in the Arabian Sea. The tanker was hit and damaged above the waterline. The tanker is owned by an Israeli businessman and registered in the name of a Haifa company named XD Management. The ship was on its way to Tanzania from India. The attack took place between India and Oman. A similar incident occurred to another tanker called the Helios Ray in the Gulf of Oman in February. Israel is investigating and will determine two important things. First, how to punish those responsible for these acts and attacks. Second, how to protect Israeli ships. Punishing those responsible for the attacks of terror might actually incentivize those making the decisions and calling the shots to stop these acts of terror and destruction against Israeli shipping, which is very important. The Biden administration is now restoring relations with the Palestinians. The first official move signaling this change in the United States policy came in the form of a speech by U.S. Ambassador to the U.N., Linda Thomas Greenfield. The ambassador spoke before the U.N. Security Council at their monthly meeting. She announced that the United States will be giving $15 million to the Palestinians for humanitarian assistance, especially food in vulnerable communities. That's vulnerable communities. She also said that the Biden administration supports Israel and that Israel is often unfairly singled out by one-sided resolutions and actions in international bodies. That too is a quote. She said that often criticism of Israel, quote, veers dangerously into anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism, as with all forms of hate, works directly against the cause of peace, unquote. This entire turnaround is troubling. Despite the kind words and caring sentiment that the UN ambassador expressed for Israel, the U.S. is resuscitating U.S.-Palestinian relations, and it will inevitably spin around and hurt Israel. Israel has detected a new Nigerian COVID variant. This new variant is closely related to the South African variant. The strength of the variant is still being studied. These variants are extremely dangerous because we don't know enough about them. They are growing in number, and it's not certain that any of our vaccines will protect people or how much they will protect people, if they protect people, against these newer and newer and newer variants. As far as we know, UK, Newark, New York, South African, Brazilian, and now Nigerian variants are out there. It appears that vaccines, to some extent, do provide protection against the UK, New York, South African variants. The Brazilian and Nigerian variants are still in question marks to be determined. The pandemic is not yet behind us. We need to be vigilant. We need to be cautious. We've been thinking out loud about a lot today. Now that you know what I've been thinking, let me know what you're thinking. Email me at micah@jbstv.org. Tweet me at Micah Halpern. Tell me what you think. Before we end, let me leave you with one picante piece of information. I mentioned the Messiah earlier, and it's not easy to explain the concept of the Messiah in Judaism. There is not a lot of solid material out there in Jewish texts to give a good understanding of the Messiah and the Messianic age. I'm being totally honest. I can, however, say with a few very near total confidences, and that's important, near total confidence, several things. The Messiah is a messenger and will bring many answers to issues that we have yet to resolve. We know that there are two messiahs. Messiah of Ben David and Mashiach Ben Yosef. That is, one descends from David and one descends from Joseph. Ben Yosef is the Messiah of war. Ben David is the Messiah of peace. The Messiah is not a synonym for the world to come. It's not heaven. Messianism is a period of time, a stage in this world. More than this, and I will get into greater speculation and greater question marks if I go and continue on. That's about all I can say about it. So I won't say anything else. No more about messianism. Thank you for thinking out loud with me, Micah Halpern. Let's think out loud again next week on JBS.